I want to talk about the strategy of pain evaluation for spinal pain and how to make a quick and precise decision making without physical examination. As a pain physician running a private pain clinic, quickly finding more precise pain generators and dramatic pain relief than any other competitors is critical for success in the harsh world. Physical examination is fundamental for all diagnostic tools and has become a norm. Orthopedic doctors and physiotherapists created it. It is not intended to evaluate the pain but measure the functional status. Of course, it helps to measure the functional status, such as limited motion. So I usually do perform physical examination, but I frequently feel that physical examination does not allow us to find pain generators. I feel like it is not my socks. So today, I focus on spinal pain evaluation, not function measurement. There are many ways to substitute the direct physical examination. Analyzing the dynamic factors and careful observation of walking and posture will help estimate the physical conditions. Don't forget the power of a simple x-ray. It contributes a lot to evaluating the spinal status. In addition, these 10-year follow-up x-rays gave an insight into the degenerative process. Then, how can I maximize the measure of pain evaluation without physical examination? It is simple. I must retrieve correct informative data from the patients to investigate the source of spinal pain as much as possible. I'll talk details further. The proper pain evaluation will guide the diagnostic and therapeutic strategy and further helps to analyze the efficacy of therapeutic intervention. I have a limited time and energy, so I desperately need a group of well-trained teams, so I am buying their precious time and energy. History taking is the first step in retrieving information from the patients and most crucial step in spinal pain evaluation. There is one thing you must remember. Most of the patients express their pain in their own language. The language reflects the characters of the person, family, and society. Therefore, even the same words may have a different meaning. Some patients with severe pain are at a loss for words. Most of the patients express their own words of pain differently according to their regional dialect containing different emotions. Some words are very absurd. Many medical practitioners push their patients to express their pain through medical terminology. It is not unusual that young doctors cannot understand the old patient's words. Interpretation of pain nature is a crucial element for classifying the spinal pain generator. So, I initialize and categorize the pain natures by interpreting the expressions of various pain and abnormal senses. Please accept the diversity of the meaning of expressions. Therefore, you must study the details of your local dialect and customize it for your clinic. Spinal pain divides into somatic and radicular pain according to pain generators. Somatic pain originates from somatic structures such as discs, facet joints, ligaments, and muscles. The radicular pain arises from dorsal root ganglion and nerve root. Unfortunately, I cannot deliver the exact word of pain expression for each pain generator because of diverse pain world internationally. But usually, the somatic pain shows the characters of deep aching and vague referred pain. And the radicular pain shows lancinating, electrical, discrete radiating pain characters. In addition to describing pain nature, the radicular pain may contain neurologic abnormalities and shows quasi-linear pain distribution. It is a diagram of referred pain that arose from sacroiliac joint. The patient feels pain in a region innervated by nerves other than the actual source of pain in case of referred pain. It is a kind of confusion of the brain perception. most of the deep somatic structures have a specific referred pain pattern. The pain rating scale is not only used for academic purposes, but also is a handy tool to determine the treatment strategy and pain management. I usually use a visual analog scale. I apply different treatment strategies according to the VAS score. My main target for interventional treatment is VAS 5 to 7. I must study aggressively if the patients express more pain than VAS 8. I do not apply injection treatment if the VAS score is less than 5. This is because the patients feel more uncomfortable with the needling procedure in the lower VAS range. Pain distribution diagram is an essential step for spinal pain evaluation. Many young pain practitioners believe that the pain refers to the dermatomal distribution. However, pain is not expressed in the corresponding dermatome, but pain distribution is close to sclerotome. The nerve root irritation study called dynatome resembles a pain sensing area. My mentor, Professor Kim, studied somatic and radicular dynatome pain distribution patterns and delivered them to the public in the past. The facet joint, disc, sacroiliac joint, and disc herniation pain have different pain distribution patterns in the lumbar spine. Most lumbar facet joint pain shows diffuse transverse low back pain without lower extremity referred pain. The lower extremity referred pain differs from the radicular pain by its vague pain and unclear distribution boundary. Some sacroiliac joint pain refers to the lateral hip to lateral thigh region. Some pain refers to inguinal region or ischial region. Most discogenic pain arises from the posterior annular tear and localized to central low back in young adults. If an annular tear enlarges and herniated disc material irritates the root, it will show a quasi-linear radicular pain pattern. In addition, it may contain sensory changes. But the aseptic discitis and subchondral bone marrow lesion show a different pattern of low back pain and referred pain. It is a long story, and I'll get a rain check for the following video. In the cervical spine, the cervical facet joint pain refers to neck and scapular region differently and consistently according to the cervical levels. The radicular pain refers to unique dynatomal distribution pattern consistently comparable to each cervical level. The cervical radicular pain may accompany paresthesia in the hand and fingers. For example, the paresthesia in the thumb indicates C6, the middle finger suggests C7, and the little finger indicates C8 nerve root. If you listen carefully to and observe the activities that worsen or relieve the pain, we will learn how the dynamic factors contribute a lot to determining the pain generators. I'll tell a simple story that many doctors confuse when listening to their patients' complaints. Some patients feel discomfort in the lower leg, but some are in the back during walking. However, many doctors do not carefully listen to the pain area, but rush to conclude growing pain during walking to diagnose spinal stenosis. It might be correct, but most of the pain is not from the spinal stenosis, but the instability, fatigue, disc, or facet joint pain. There are other factors to observe during an interview. However, these factors are also crucial to correctly measuring spinal pain. It is my conclusion. It is an essence to make a proper spinal diagnosis. We should consider and understand the multiple factors of pain generation. I need multiple approaches, including physiological and anatomical, to understand the underlying mechanism. Careful listening to the pain complaints, observing the patients, and reasonably analyzing them become guidelines for next step. The evaluation after nerve block is the last thing that you should not forget. So, careful listening, observation, and detailed pain charting are the fastest and best to evaluate spinal pain properly. Thank you for watching. See you in the following videos.